Hello, kids. Welcome to Tina's Terminology with me, your favorite vocabulary expert. Our first word today is eccentric. Eccentric is an adjective that's used to describe a person or their behavior as strange or unusual. For example, did you notice what Dion was wearing today? He looked very eccentric.
Hey guys, it's me, Scott. I'm at Circle B Bar Reserve in Lakeland today to take a walk through nature and learn about all kinds of cool plants and animals. Come with me and check it out. I'm here with Tabitha Beal. She works with the environmental lands in our Polk County parks. She's going to teach us a little bit about Circle B and what our Polk County parks have to offer. So Tabitha, we have parks all over Polk County. What are the names of some of those parks and what makes them so special for our county?
So we do have a lot of parks all over Polk County, and what makes our different places unique is in our environmental land sites, the parks are managed for the natural resources. So we really highlight the beauty of nature at our parks, and what that means is you get to see lots of wildlife, you get to see pretty lakes, nice streams that are clean, and beautiful landscapes that are maintained by natural resources managers.
This park that we're at today is Circle B, and it's very popular with its visitors. Can you tell me some things that make Circle B so popular and unique?
So Circle B Bar Reserve is a 1,267 acre property. It's a huge piece of property. About half of it is wetlands. And why people come here from all over the world to see Polk County and Central Florida is because how much wildlife you get to see. You get to see alligators, turtles, roseate spoonbills, which most people think are flamingos because they're pink, but they're not. They're roseate spoonbills. You see bald eagles flying. You see lots and lots of wildlife. And the way the site was designed is the trails go through their habitat. So you are walking through the home of these animals. And you get to see them up close in their natural behaviors.
What are some fun things that families can do together when they come out to Circle B?
So that's a great question. There's lots to do out here. You can hike the trails, and it's free. You can visit the Nature Center, which is free. You can bring a picnic out and enjoy one of the picnic shelters and have lunch with your family, and that's for free. So there's lots of free things to do. And most recently, we started a new app that we have, and it's called a Discovery Agents app that you can download on your phone. And as you're hiking the trails, different avatars or different characters will pop up like an alligator and tell you a little bit more about their home here at Circle B Bar Reserve.
That's so cool. I hear that you have a lot of different trails with different lengths and shade options, so everyone can find one that's best for them. Can you tell me about those?
Yeah, we have the trails allow for all abilities of traveling. And so we have trails, the most popular is our Alligator Alley Trail. It's 2.5 miles long and it loops back to the Nature Center into the parking area. And that takes you along Lake Hancock. There's an observation dock, benches along the way. But there's also shorter segments. There's, you know, you can hike a 1/2 mile out to see a lot of wildlife as well. And then there's longer ones. You can go 3.5 miles loops back around to the Nature Center. So there's lots of different variety. Almost all the trails have benches along the way, so you can take a moment to take a stop and relax and enjoy nature and relax in it and take a break from walking. But they also have a couple observation areas along the way too, where you can see further into the marsh or out into the lake.
The coolest part about Circle B has to be the nature that you can see here. What types of plants and animal habitats will I see if I go hiking on the trails?
So the cool thing about Central Florida is that we have a lot of different types of habitats. And what I mean that is you see complete different variety of vegetation when you move from one level of elevation to a higher level of elevation. And Circle B is no different than that. We start out here where we're standing in the beautiful hammock here at Circle B, which is a shaded place dominated by large trees. In our case, it's large oak trees. You move out into the wetlands, which is seasonally wet and sometimes very, very wet. And it's an open marsh system. So it's very treeless, but lots of grasses and shrubs and herbaceous kind of items out there. there. Then you can move on to our uplands, and that area is just, it's like you're walking on beachfront property. Sugar sand, super duper deep down into the ground, and a very arid, dry, almost desert-like region. So even here at Circle B, you have these three main areas that you can visit while you're here.
Earlier, you mentioned a Discover Center, and it's such a cool place for kids to learn. What will they find inside?
So the Discovery Center was designed to sort of be the hub of what is available here in Polk County for natural resources. And so when you walk inside, we wanted to give you sort of an introduction of what kind of habitats, like we just talked about, exist here in Central Florida. So you walk into the hammock. So you walk inside and you're still in the hammock. Large oak tree with a cool tree house for kids to go up and explore. Around the backside, we want you to keep exploring the animals that live in these areas. And so we've put a lot of little critters hidden throughout the inside exhibit hall for you to look for, but the one of the ones most people like to visit is the fox and her baby fox. And so if you go around the back side of the tree, it actually goes down underground into the fox's den, and the kids can go down there with their family if they would like to go down there and explore. And then you move on around the exhibit hall and you'll see our flatwoods and our upland systems, and there's also an aquarium that shows off our lakes, our polluted and versus pristine lakes, and some of the fish that you may see and some of the vegetation you may see in those environments. But the exhibit hall isn't the only part for kids to enjoy while they're here. It's not just indoors, we want them to play outdoors. So just outside the exhibit hall, there's also a nature explore outdoor play area too, where they can play with natural building blocks, messy materials, try to design themselves an eagle's nest that they actually can get inside of. There's a sandbox area to make animal tracks across. So there's lots of things to do here at the center as well.
Thank you so much for teaching me about Circle B, Tabitha. You can visit Circle B with your parents for free and have a fun day in the outdoors. I'm going to go hike on one of those trails now and see what types of animals I can find. I'll see you guys next time.
Hey everybody, I'm Ariana and I'm here at Exploration's 5 Children's Museum for this segment of Senses Overdrive. This is Sue. She's going to be helping us with our activity today. So Sue, what are we doing?
Well, first of all, I'm going to look at this and I want you to tell me what you see.
Two faces.
You see two faces? You know what I see?
What do you see?
I see a vase, a beautiful vase. It's got some narrow and wide parts.
I see that now.
So we're going to make one with you.
Okay.
As the faces, and see what kind of vase you'll make.
Okay.
So I have a folded piece of paper right here. We're going to put this up on the wall right here. We're mm-hmm. going to shine a light on your face, so you just keep looking this way. Don't worry about what I'm doing here, okay? And what I'm going to do is I'm going to trace this on the piece of paper. Once we trace this, then I'll be cutting it out. Stand still. Or you'll be cutting it out, actually, to see what it is that we get. All right, that was quick.
Okay.
So here you are, and there are the scissors right there. So we cut that out, and then we're gonna put you onto here. See what we have.
Okay.
I'm like giving you a pair of little kid scissors, huh?
Okay.
So you can do this with your friends. You can have a guessing game to see who it is that you can see in there.
Oh, that'd be fun.
All right, so the piece that we're going to use is this right here.
Okay.
All right, so it's going to look like this. So blue on this side. And all this takes is two pieces of paper, a pair of scissors, and a light.
Some glue.
And some blue. There you are.
Oh, I look like the picture.
I don't know, do you?
No, not really.
I think this is a prettier vase.
Thank you.
There you go.
Thank you. That was so much fun. And if you really want to put your senses into overdrive, come here in downtown Lakeland to Exploration's 5 Children's Museum. I'm Ariana, see you again soon.
Our first word of the day is an excellent adjective. And remember, an adjective is a word that describes a person, place, or thing. Eccentric is a word that is used to describe a person whose behavior is unconventional and strange. For example, take Englishman Jayme Hurst, who lived from 1738 to 1829. As a young boy at school, he kept a pet jackdaw and trained a hedgehog to follow him around. Unfortunately, his eccentric habits got him expelled.
Okay, kids, are you ready to play Where's That At? The game show quiz that takes you around the world. Okay then, let's get started. Here's question number one. This country is made up entirely of islands, which includes more than 17,500 islands. One of the islands, called Java, has more than 140 million people living on it, making it the most populous island in the world. When you combine all of their islands together, this country is the fourth most populous country in the world and is located in between the Indian Ocean and the Philippine Sea. They are famous for all of their volcanoes, and this country is also the home of the Komodo dragon and the orangutan. It is the only place in the world where they are found living in the wild. Is it A, Romania, B, Greenland, or C, Indonesia? Well, if you guessed Indonesia, then you're right. With more than 238 million people, Indonesia is the fourth most populous country in the world behind China, India, and the United States. Indonesia has 147 volcanoes, 76 of which are still active, making it the world's most active volcano country. And somewhere in the country, there will be an earthquake approximately 3 times a day. Marco Polo was the first European to ever travel to Indonesia 700 years ago in 1292. All right, are you ready to get started with question number two? Let's do it. This country has a population of 63 million people and is the most visited country in the world. It is home to one of the most famous paintings in the world, the Mona Lisa. This country built and gave the Statue of Liberty to the United States on the 4th of July in 1881. This country is known for their fine foods, cheeses, and wine. Is it A, France, B, Mexico, or C, Kazakhstan? That's right, it's France! This giant Statue of Liberty in New York City was actually a gift from France. It was built by a guy named Gustave Eiffel, the same guy that built the famous Eiffel Tower in Paris. Paris is actually the capital of France and is also where the museum called the Louvre is located. And inside that museum are some of the most valuable paintings in the world, including the Mona Lisa. France played a major role in the United States fight for independence and was a key European battleground in World War II. So now you know a little bit about the Southeast Asian country called Indonesia and the European country of France. Thanks for playing Where's That At? With me. I'll see you next time.
It's me again. I'm here at the Color of the Trail Run at Bone Valley ATV Park. This is a 5K that's sponsored by Polk County, and Polk County sponsors events like this all the time for you to come enjoy with your family and friends. I'm gonna hit the trail here at Bone Valley. Come along with me. We'll be right back. The color run may be over, but I'm not done running yet. Let's head out to another Polk County park where you can get active. Now I'm here at the South Lake Howard Nature Park right here in Winter Haven. It's a great place for a peaceful walk or a jog. Now come with me on a half mile walk. My journey just ended, but if you want to see some really cool animals or have an awesome day out in the Florida sun, come on out to any one of Polk County's beautiful nature parks or trails. I'll see you next time on Power Up.
Our second term of the day is another adjective that's funny to say out loud. Bumptious is a word used to describe a person who's proud or confident in a loud and rude way that annoys other people. A bumptious person is cocky, aggressive, and loud. Can you think of anyone who's bumptious in your life? Go up to them and say, "Hey, stop being bumptious."
Hey everybody, it's me, Beau. It's time for another simple but delicious snack. Today, we're going to make a snack mix that you won't want to put down. It's a great alternative to a bag of chips or a normal salty snack. We're calling it Cheesy Chex Mix. This recipe is a little bit more work than some of our other recipes, but it pays off in how delicious it is. You're going to want to get an adult to help you out because we're going to be using the oven on this one. Let's go ahead and preheat our oven to 325 degrees. Preheating the oven lets the oven get hot while we're preparing our ingredients. That way, we don't have to wait as long to enjoy our yummy snack. We have a few things that we need in order to get started. We're going to need 3 cups of Chex cereal, 2 cups of mini pretzels, 1 cup of cheese crackers, 1/2 cup of grated Parmesan cheese, 1/2 stick of melted butter, and just a pinch of garlic powder. We also need a gallon-sized zipper bag to mix all of the ingredients in. Now let's start putting our ingredients together. Combine all of the ingredients into your bag. Add in your crunchy snacks like the Chex cereal, pretzels, and cheese crackers first. And then add in your cheese and garlic powder. Once all of those ingredients are in the bag, add in the last one, which is your melted butter. seal that bag up really tight and shake it around to mix it all together. Once you can see that it's mixed really well, take your baking sheet and pour your mixture onto it. Spread it out nicely so that it can cook evenly. If your oven is preheated now, have an adult help you put this into the oven and set the timer to bake for 15 minutes. That's gonna cook for 15 minutes. We'll be right back. Once the timer goes off, you or your parent can take it out, but make sure you use an oven mitt because it'll be very hot. Let it cool so it doesn't burn your mouth. And enjoy! I'm going to have some myself. This is so good! I love the cheese crackers the best. You can mix it up with your favorite types of salty snacks or different seasonings too, so it never gets old. Tune in next time for more simple snacks. I'm Beau. See you soon.
Did you think of anyone bumptious who you might know? Well, here's an example if you couldn't think of anyone. Veruca Sald from Charlie and the Chocolate Factory is a perfect example of a bumptious brat. That means she's proud or confident in a loud or rude way that annoys other people. Thank you for joining me on Tina's Terminology this month. Come back next time to expand your mind with more vocabulary.
Welcome to the Polk County History Center. My name is Jayme Jameson and I'm the Curator of Education and Programming. Today I thought we would take a walk around the exhibits and look at some of the early transportation that was used to bring people and goods in and out of Polk County. So, when Polk County was first settled in the 1850s, there were railroads in the United States, but of course there were none running into this area. The early settlers traveled by wagon. It wasn't an easy ride. Most of our roads were still sand, and if you've ever tried running through sand on the beach, you know it can be pretty tricky to get footing and get through. Well, the same was true for the wagons. If you were to break your wagon wheel, you'd also be stuck for at least a few hours until you could figure out how to fix one of your spokes. So when the early settlers came, they came in wagons, but as Polk County progressed and through the Civil War and after the Civil War, a new mode of transportation cropped up. And I say cropped up because it was used mostly to transport not just people but also goods. So Polk County's earliest settlers were very involved in agriculture. They farmed products, they gathered things such like Spanish moss and sable palm, and they hunted different animals for fur and meat. Now in order to make a profit off of that work and effort, they needed to transport their goods to other markets. And the best way to transport goods was fast and in bulk, meaning lots at one time. And the best method of transportation for that was the railroad. Railroads were not prevalent in Polk County during the Civil War. In fact, it wouldn't be until the 1880s that the first railroads came through, and very much on the demand of the people living in Polk County. They wanted to get their goods to different markets, and they wanted a way to get people into Polk County. The trains brought goods and people in specific order. They were regulated, they went on certain times, but in addition to all of the people and the goods, the most important crop that it carried, or two items that it carried out of Polk County, were phosphate and citrus. Phosphate was really interesting. The trains actually pulled up directly to the phosphate mines, loaded the phosphate pebble, which is used to make fertilizer, and took it off to destinations to help grow more and more crops. Citrus, on the other hand, had to be very carefully transported. Citrus is an important crop for Florida, and it grows abundantly in Florida due to our climate. And if we were to load all that citrus up in the train and send it up to a northern market, let's say Chicago, Philadelphia, or New York City, it had the potential to freeze. And so citrus farmers and transporters actually had an ingenious method to keep their citrus warm. They actually put charcoal heaters in the train cars to keep the citrus warm as it journeyed to the northern markets. Now, we talked about wagons and we talked about trains, but in the early 1900s, a brand new invention was allowing people to transport individually themselves and their families to new locations. And those, of course, were the roads. Roads were becoming a very important part of travel in the United States of America in the early 1900s, and Polk County was very interested in inviting and welcoming those road travelers. So much so that in 1914, the county voted to approve spending $1.5 million to pave asphalt roads for driving. The $1.5 million would originally have paved about 270 miles of road. In the end, they spent almost $3 million and paved nearly 346 miles of highway. They erected these signs to welcome people to the county, but there was also a different road project being constructed, and it was called the Dixie Highway. The Dixie Highway, unlike asphalt like the Polk County roads, was actually paved with brick. And you can drive out to Loffman near Davenport at the old Tampa Highway. You can actually see the old brick road that dates back to 1917. In addition to that, the county built these giant markers that greeted people right when they came into Polk County. Specifically, it said October 1930 when they were placed, and it says, "Welcome to Polk County, Citrus Center." Except on the Osceola border, somebody didn't proofread when they were chiseling, and one of them says Citrus instead of Citrus Center. And that is the marker you can go see if you go look at the Dixie Highway in Davenport. If you're interested in exploring some of these markers or these old roads or the old train depots, you can stop by the Polk County History Center and we can give you a map and some information on where to go to see specifically our old depots that are still around in Polk County as well as the Dixie Highway. And I hope that you come by car, and I hope that you have a safe ride, and we see you at the Polk County History Center soon.